the question is, how do we set down our instability? So how do we get to that point where we can set instability down as instability, not as something that we stabilized, but as realizing we cannot stabilize instability? That's the realization. What is instability? Thinking. What is thinking? Perception. Sensory perception. Perception. Period. Just perception. Perception implies something other than pure awareness of isness. Cause and effect. Time, space. How do we set time, space, perception, thinking, instability down? By realizing we can't stabilize it. We cannot stabilize it. It cannot be stabilized. Its whole purpose is to be unstable. That's what it is. Instability is instability. So how do we get to this amazing decision to set instability down as instability? Our tendency is to try and stabilize instability. That's the mistake we make. All of us. That's the great delay. There's no stability in instability. There is not. It's a deception. All the belief that we're finding stability within in instability is self-deception. So, what I have done here is lay out the reasoning behind setting it down. And that is to say that spirit, one will with God, there's just one will, God's will, and spirit is the one will also. It's an expansion of the will of God. Spirit thought, hey, Let me see if I can create separately from God. I want to be prime creator. Let me try. As an adventure, I want to see if I can do this. So what spirit wants to do is wants to create differently than God creates. God's creation is everything, all-knowing, just a knowingness. Spirit knows that it is one. So what spirit wants to do is create creations, extensions of itself, that don't know, that do not know, that don't know the Creator, what created it, that thinks it's separate. But spirit says, how in the world am I going to do that? So what spirit does is it's creating like backwards. It's what it's trying to do is bring about this instability. Instability. And then it wants this perception, thinking, instability to be seen as the creator of its creations instead of spirit being the creator. This is why we have all this instability of perception, thinking. And really our attempts to stabilize it are just a delaying tactic. Is we're waiting for the birth of our child within this instability of perception and thinking. So that we can experience this. Because this instability, we don't like it. We want to set it down. But we think, well, if we set it down, we'll never get to experience this creating differently than God. So we keep working to stabilize thinking, stabilize instability. It's like trying to make duality one. We keep striving for oneness within duality. This is a delaying tactic. Waiting for the birth of this child. It's like we've set up the nursery, the house, the nursery, everything, the hospital, everything's set up. We have this hospital, the nursery at home set up, the hospital is all set up, the doctors are all there, the birthing room is there, and nurses are there. Everything is so set up. We're waiting for the birth of this child, who will be born, and say, oh, I know my creator. It's this thinking and perception. That's my creator. And then we get to experience this child not knowing what created it, which is we be spirit. So we're waiting for that experience. And as we wait for it, we desperately strive to maintain all this, even though we don't really want it. We don't like it. We want to set it down. Because we are as God created us, and we cannot get rid of that feeling of that we want to stop this ridiculous denial and charade, this attempt at separation. So in this delaying tactic, we try to unify duality. We try to stabilize our thinking. All these efforts. This is what interferes with setting it down, actually. You might say the effort for enlightenment is what gets in the way of enlightenment. Meaning, the effort to stabilize thinking, to enlighten thinking, is what gets in the way of setting it down. The effort to stabilize instability is what gets in the way of simply setting instability down. And we believe that our efforts to stabilize instability are efforts towards enlightenment. They're not. Those are efforts towards delay. What we desire is this experience of creating differently than God. We cannot have such an experience. We can only have the experience of setting it all up in anticipation. We can only have the experience of anticipation, but never the actual experience. So it's an anticipatory experience. So this is the rationale, the reasoning behind what we're doing is setting instability down as instability, not as something that we've stabilized. The idea that we have to stabilize instability and then set it down, that is delusion. That is delay. That is how we keep hope alive that we can experience a new creation separate from God that doesn't know its creator. And we think we'll be unfulfilled. We'll be a creator without a creation if we do this. But that is not so. It seems so, though. That's what's making us feel like, wow, I'm going to be unhappy. I will be unhappy. Forever unfulfilled. Like a mother without a child. That's what we believe. This overlooks, of course, that everything is, we are co-creators with all that is, and continue to co-create and expand all that is. So there's no actual unfulfillment. But because of our desire, it'll be an unfulfilled desire, we believe. But the desire to not create, it's good to have that unfulfilled. The desire to annihilate ourselves, it's good to have that unfulfilled. There's nothing wrong with unfulfilling that. the desire to imprison ourselves is good that that is unfulfilled. And it's really just a whim. So what we're doing here that's different than other approaches is giving the context, the rich context of why is it that we struggle and what's the struggle about? Instead of just saying, you know, set instability down as instability. But then we're going to say, well, what, why? We feel resistance. Well, what, why? Why? We're going to lose something. We feel we lose something. If we understand what we've been trying to do, it seems to make it easier. We don't feel quite lost. It's zero times zero instead of setting zero and multiplication down entirely. We say it's zero times zero. Okay, we see what we've been trying to do. So let's set instability down as instability. We're not going to cure thinking, because the whole purpose of thinking is confusion. All right, that's the whole purpose. We want to give thinking to our creation, what we create. So what we create is confused. And it's thinking that it's going to find an answer, and yet never does. There's no answer in thinking. Thinking is all about 20 is 20. What's the difference between 20 times 0 and 21 times 0? And thinking, well, between 20 and 21, and thoughts are occupied with it. 20 and 21. Thinking, not realizing that they're actually both being multiplied by 0. 0 value, 0 truth, 0 reality. That's thinking. There's no stability in thinking. All thinking does is look at these equally meaningless alternatives. That's what thinking is. That's what thinking does. That's what it is. That's like saying a limited perception of allness, of everywhereness. How do you compare that to some other limited perception of allness? And what's the meaning of that in relation to allness? There's no meaning. There's no meaning. That's what thinking is. Thinking is thinking, okay, I have this limited perception, and what's the difference between this limited perception and this limited perception and this limited perception? And which limited perception is better? Which was more satisfying in relation to what? To allness? If only allness satisfies us, why are we talking about satisfaction in relationship to limited perception or thinking? So again, it's all a charade that we're doing because we want to give this to our creations. This is what we want our creations to experience. But actually, there are no creations, separate creations. So we're the ones that are experiencing this. We're it's like a poison that we have in our hand. We want to give this poison to our creations, and yet all the while it's poisoning us because we're holding on to it like that. There is no honor among thoughts and thinking. There is no honorable thinking. There is no stable thinking. To put honor to it is another attempt at stability. Thinking is not stable. There's no stability in it. Because what its objective is to establish value where there is no value. So how could that be stable? Doesn't it always have to be unstable? Blaming. Say, no, the instability is back there. 20 is the one that's unstable. 21's stable. It's just the instability of 20 that's the problem. That needs to go away. But but then I need to see it. I need something to blame so I don't realize that 21 is no stability. 21 times 0 is 02. So you need the 20 to blame. You see, duality needs duality. You can't just say, okay, 21, that's it. That's stability, just 21, nothing else. Because then you'd realize it's 21 times 0. And there's no stability in that at all, is there? So you have to have 21 and 20, so that 21 can blame 20 for the instability. And then when it gets close to realization, it flip-flops and says, oh, I had a realization. It's 20 that's stable, and it's 21 that's wrong. It's the instabilities with 21. So it has to be a duality. Instability has to be a duality. You cannot have a singularity with thinking. You cannot have singularity with thinking. It's impossible. Thinking would stop. There wouldn't be any thinking. Because thinking is, I'm thinking about why, where's that instability coming from? It's not, you know, say, well, I'm thinking of what's stable and what isn't. That's a duality, isn't it? In reality, there's no concept of stability at all. Isness is. There isn't anything other than that. All everywhereness is everywhere. Right now. But thinking is always between two equally meaningless, non-values, with one being preferred over the other. Now thinking may flip-flop really fast and say one to the other, and think that it's making progress because it's not resting upon one for very long. But it's still completely bound to two-ness, to duality, to one or the other. But having to have both, always both. Twenty-one times zero cannot rest on itself. It has to be 21 times zero saying, but 20 times zero is the problem. Not 21. 21's different, you see. It says, it can't be the same problem. It's different. 21 times zero can't be the same as 20 times zero because 21's different than 20. So there has to be this difference in thinking. There has to be a duality. And that's instability, isn't it? It's inherently unstable thinking. So we cannot stabilize thinking. We have to set it down as the instability that it is. Which means then we cannot create separately from God. That's finished, right? That's so. Because if we're seeing the oneness, our creations also, we would know the oneness. We're not having thinking in between us and our creations. So what we're really thinking is our creations will be unfulfilled because they won't see us as prime creator. Like saying we need to be prime creator so our creations are fulfilled by having a prime creator. But that's trying to create separately from God. How about creating with God? And we think of what our creations will be unfulfilled. Well, but we're co-creating. We're co-creating. So our creations will be fulfilled because our creations also will co-create. So we can, what I realized this morning, we're all just one simple step away, always. And this is what's so frustrating. You realize, like, I can say my entire life I've been just that close to enlightenment. Just one simple step away, always. And it's very frustrating. And I realized I was saying, there was this argument in my thinking of, well, who gets the honor of the last thought? There is no last thought, though, is there? What do you mean last thought? That 21 is right? No, because 21 is still in relation to 20. It's still dualistic. So the last thought is still dualistic thought. There is no singular thought. There is no singular thinking. No singularity within thinking. Dualistic thinking. So where's the honor? You can't find an honorable thought. Cannot. So I realized I've been trying to find what thought gets the honor to be the last thought before I set it down, you know. And that's what I'm trying to determine, you know. And I'm delaying over this. And the tendency is to get very angry at yourself. You say, you mean I've spent my whole life and I'm delaying some severe crisis problems, pragmatic problems. I'm delaying because I'm trying to decide what thought gets the last honor to be the last thought before I set it thinking down. And you just say, my God, you know, is so stupid. It's so incredibly stupid. But one has to not react that way. Remember, we're in a mood of repentance. So if the mood of repentance is your basic commitment, and it has to be, really, then you say, no, I can't react that way. I'm obligated. You know, I have this commitment. I made this commitment. I'm obligated to remain in the mood of repentance. So you do not react emotionally, or at least you back off any sort of anger or accusation of stupidity, all of that. Say, no, I can't do it that way. I'm committed to the path of repentance. And that makes all the difference in the world. You see, there does need to be like a commitment to a path that you, so that even when you cannot understand why you shouldn't be angry or upset or react, you still say, out of faith, that in commitment to the path, I'm going to stay calm anyway. It's essential. It's essential. Which now I can see that commitment to a path, to a religion, commitment to something is actually very helpful, can be helpful, theoretically. But it has to be commitment to the mood of repentance, where you will remain calm, non-emotional, non-accusatory, forgiving. And what this enables one to then look at it carefully. And see what the confusion is. Because there has to still be some confusion. So why am I not setting it thinking down? I'm trying to determine who gets the honor of what gets the honor of being the last thought. But looking at it carefully, thinking is dualistic. There is no last thought. There has never been honorable thinking. There can never be honorable thinking, because thinking is always blaming. It's projecting blame. It's saying 21 is stable because 20 isn't. What's the honor in that? 21 times 0 is stable because 20 times 0 isn't stable. That's dual. There's no honor in that. There's no sanity in that. So you can't find an honorable last thought. So as long as we're trying to find an honorable last thought, we won't set it down because we can't find it. So of course it's a huge issue here that requires the utmost calm to look at it. Utmost forgiveness and calm, saying, in order to you know, see clearly here. So the real honor is the honoring the commitment to the mood of repentance. That's the honor. It's, you know, basic honor like that is important for a culture and society. I was at Home Depot a couple days ago, and this lady was scanning my material, what I was buying, my purchases, and she scanned these bins. She goes, "Oh, how many you got there? Two. One, two. Okay." And I said, "I think there are three." At first, I thought maybe I miscounted, and then I said, "No, I don't think so." I said, "I think there are three. Better, you know, let's check it out again." And she goes, "Oh, you're right. There's three." She said, "Oh," she goes, "Wow, you almost got a free bin." You know, so my honor, you see, my honor said, "Hey, you have to be honorable and tell the truth." You know, she was offering me, you know, dishonor. Say, "Hey, you can get a free one." I could easily said nothing. And she was kind of like perplexed why I, you know, said that. And it was a setup. I could tell it was a setup in some way. I said, no. There's three. There's three. So we do need to be honorable, but we need to choose what it is that we're honorable about. And I say, must choose the mood of repentance. It's all important. And you could call this quote unquote a religion. A religion is actually a situation of honor where people choose, they're going to choose this reaction or style of response, even in the midst of tremendous pressure. Okay? So, even in the midst of this tremendous pressure of seeing that I've been delaying over this, you know, what seems to be utterly ridiculous. Ridiculousness, and I could see clarity was right there. Unthinking clarity, thought-free clarity, thinking-free clarity. I was aware of it. I was also aware I'm avoiding that simply by trying to find which thought to honor. And it's just like, oh my God, you know, it's like not opening a treasure chest because you're thinking, you know, which finger gets to lift the lid. Which gets the finger gets the honor, you know. And you spend a whole lifetime trying to figure out which finger gets the honor, and you're never lifting the lid. You know, it's that stupid. But the training to remain in the mood of repentance kicked in. And so I did not go all volatile about it. Just remained humble and said, "Wow, this is really something. But I have to look at this. I have to look more carefully at this. Don't rush to judgment. Don't get angry and upset. You know, there's no rush to judgment here. Staying forgiving, humble, repentant. I have a severe continuity problem. That's what's making me so stupid. I have a severe continuity problem." So these are professions of faith. These are articles of faith, meaning you can see clearly why it's so important. Therefore, when you don't see so clearly and you're under all this pressure to react, you say, no, I'm going to go on faith right now and say, I'm not going to react. I'm going to stay calm. This is what religion is really all about. Those who say that they don't need any religion at all are fooling themselves. Because when they see something like this, if they saw something like this, as I did, and say, "Oh my God, paradise is right here. All suffering vanished. Paradise is right here, and I'm spending all my time thinking about, you know, which finger gets the honor, lift the lid, It's like so stupid. It's unbelievably stupid, right? If you don't have that commitment to the mood of repentance, you're going to just be apoplectic about it and just, you know, want to kill yourself. You'd be so angry. Truly. You can't handle this kind of insight. You can't see it. Won't be able to see it. Your reactions will, long before you see this, your anger towards yourself will knock you off track. Way. The only way I could see this stupidity is because I have the mood of repentance. It's the only way. That's why you see religions practicing calm, dispassion, detachment, calm, which is really the mood of repentance. I'm not going to get angry at myself. I'm not going to vilify myself. I'm not going to react in an emotional, accusatory, angry way. I'm going to say, okay, I see this incredible stupidity. Okay. I'm just going to say, wow. Just wow, that's all. Wow. I have a severe continuity problem, which is why I don't have a stupidity problem, I have a severe continuity problem. This is the basic profession of faith that I see, which keeps you calm, because it's the truth. Obviously, we would not be holding on to this stupidity if we didn't have a severe continuity problem. Because if we set this stupidity down, we are going to be in paradise, just like that, in the paradise of pure clarity. Without need for any thought at all, without the need for the slightest bit of thinking whatsoever. Undisturbed clarity, totally undisturbed clarity, pure clarity. So, and we're like, wow, yeah, I don't know if I'm ready for that. So we hold on to the stupidity. So, you know, don't blame the stupidity. It's the continuity problem that's our problem. So the managing we need to focus on the continuity problem and how to manage pure clarity. It's there. I saw it this morning. It is most certainly there. It's right here, right now. Without a need for any thinking whatsoever, because what is thinking? Confusion. Lack of clarity. Pure clarity, effortless pure clarity is ours right now. That treasure chest is right here. And we're arguing about which finger to use. That's a continuity problem, obviously. In large, we have this fear of unfulfilled, you know, desire and such, but we still stay calm. You can't get this far if you don't have this mood of repentance, dispassion, you know, the whole mood of repentance, humility. To see, oh, what a fool I have been, oh my gosh, incredible stupidity, you know, and have to just remain calm with this. Because the tendency is just to do this burn, you know, you just oh, you know, I've not been experiencing this treasure because I'm thinking about which finger gets the honor, you know. It's literally that stupid. It's literally that stupid. So we do have to get to this point of this incredible stupidity, get it out in the open, and still remain in the mood of repentance here. And don't castigate ourselves. And yet, yes, it is incredible stupidity. But we don't have to castigate ourselves. That doesn't solve anything. because it's simply a continuity problem. There is no right answer which finger gets to lift the lid of the treasure box. There isn't any right answer or honorable answer. The answer actually is there is no lid to the treasure box. You see, our continuity fear is putting a lid there and then saying, well, how do we lift the lid? And then saying, okay, we lift the lid with our fingers. Okay, but which finger is best to lift the lid? You know, which is the more honorable finger? Trying to say there's honor in our thinking when there isn't. It's all continuity fear. You know, it's all one package. It's all one package. So when we see there isn't any lid, then we say, well, what about my honor? How do I establish honor in my thinking? We cannot. Well, then how can I have an honorable creation in thinking? We cannot have a creation separate from God. So the idea of honorable is a moot point, isn't it? So if we're never going to create a separate child from us, creation of separation, then we don't have to worry about them knowing how dishonorable we were. It's between us and God, not between us and some separate creation that we think was going to take place. This unborn child, we're worried about, well, how is this child going to view us if it views us as so stupid and dishonorable and stuff? There isn't going to be any child. So salvation is between us and God, not between us and some imaginary child that we're never going to have. Afraid our child's gonna think that we're so stupid that once we thought there was a lid on the box and there wasn't any, and we thought that thinking was honorable and it wasn't, and so we're thinking, wow, we're really an unfit parent, you know, for this child. Well, there isn't any child. There isn't going to be any child of separation, no separate creation. So there's only the oneness. There's only the oneness. And the oneness is not judging us at all. We're judging ourselves, thinking, how is our separate creation going to judge us? Or judge what we've done? And it'll judge us as a failure, we think, because there is no honorable thinking. There is no lid on the box. And we think our child will know its creator and judge us as a failure. Say, oh, you failed to create me separate from you. What a failure you are. And it'll see itself as a failure. You know, this is this. We just need to look at this. Since there isn't going to be any such child, this is all much ado about nothing. But you can see how we would be reacting. I can see this. It's all very quite a funny thing. And when we're able to laugh about it, that'll be the end of it. Right now, I'm just looking at it. You see, if we created a child as an extension of God, a co-creation, the child's not going to be disappointed. We're assuming that the child will be disappointed because we failed to create it separately. But what does a child, unborn child, know about the motives of the parent? They're going to say, oh my gosh, I'm so disappointed because you didn't create me separate from you, didn't create me a miserable, suffering wretch. So I'm so disappointed in you. You're not prime creator. But if there isn't going to be such a child, an absurd concern, isn't it? It's an absurdity, for sure. But we need to look at this absurdity. We've forgotten to laugh at this absurdity. Okay, and don't struggle with it. I'm starting to struggle a little bit, so I've got to back away from that. Just put up with the feeling. Don't struggle with it. Just put up with it. Just reference it and put up with it. Just continue to breathe. Don't struggle mentally thinking with it. When we start struggling, it means it's getting a little too heavy for you, you know. It's like, wow. I've just seen the absurdity of it all. You know, wow, just honor the wow of that. Not the thinking of it, just the wow of it, you know. Oh. And remain calm. See, I can remain calm to a large extent, even seeing this complete absurdity. Not going crazy. I just have this, wow, that's very absurd. That's all. We're not reacting. We're not projecting the absurdity. We're not blaming someone else for the absurdity. We're not doing any of that. We say, hey, yeah, this is my absurdity. This is absurdity I've been entertaining. That's all. So the mood of repentance enables this absurdity to be seen. I just saw it. We've just been looking at it. Now, it doesn't remain clear right at this point because the reaction to it is wow. It's just so. Don't struggle to try and clarify it. Once you've clarified it, then there's the wow reaction. And then you just have to abide in this wow reaction. And so don't struggle to get the clarity back immediately. That's when you get off the track. The train starts getting off the track. It's just this total absurdity. This total absurdity is at the root of our troubles. So be happy we've been able to see this total absurdity and are in the reaction to it right now. I'm in the reaction phase to this. Is it a bad feeling? No, because in seeing, clearly seeing it, there's a very positive aspect to that. And it's like, wow, I believe I can get free of that. I believe I can laugh at that. I believe that's very laughable. Yeah. So it's not a depressed feeling. There are elements of letdown and disappointment and wow. It's like, but it's also balanced by, hey, this is great. I was able to get to this. This is fantastic. This is what I wanted. I wanted to get to this. So it's balanced out in reaction-wise. So don't try to imbalance it one way or the other. Just feel that, hey, it's okay. It's okay. It's okay to see this absurdity. And honor the continuity fear. Don't try to push yourself into, you know, laughing at it and that's it. And maintain the balance of it, but there's a wow to it, for sure there's a wow. It's just like, don't try to go too fast at this point. You know, honor the fact that you have a severe continuity problem. That's the honoring. Not your thinking, but put your honor onto the continuity problem. Put your honor there. There you go. That's the answer. So, when you see that the treasure chest has no lid, and you're seeing the treasure, you're saying, well, what do I do with the honor? What do I give the honor to? Give the honor to the continuity problem. All honor to the continuity problem. So then we're not thinking anymore. We're not thinking about which finger lifted the lid. You know, where was the honor? What happened to the honor? No, the honor's still here. The honor, all honor to the continuity problem, which is honoring our creativity. You see, this issue of honor is important because we feel we do need to honor our creativity in trying to deceive ourselves, self-deception, this long absurdity of self-deception. So don't try to get rid of this issue of honor. Put it where it needs to be put, which is on the continuity problem. Say, I honor the continuity problem. I really honor the continuity. All honor to the continuity problem. And then this gives a balanced feeling so that this treasure can be seen. And we still feel, you know, that there's this, it's like zero times zero. I'm honoring multiplication, right? Which means I'm honoring my creativity in creating this absurd scenario of self-deception, of dreaming, of fantasy, of meaninglessness. So shift the issue of honor onto the continuity problem, not our thinking. Obviously, if there was no lid, there can't be the honor of lifting the lid, right? So if we want the honor of lifting the lid and not realizing we can put it on the honor onto the continuity problem, we will obsess about, well, which finger gets the honor? And we'll never come up with an answer, because if there is no lid, how can there be the honor of lifting the lid? It's impossible. And so we will think we're making progress by our thinking. I say, wait a minute, I've narrowed it down to one of these five fingers that gets the honor. And right now I'm thinking maybe it's the first finger. You see, maybe it's this finger. And the other ones, I'm thinking that they're, you know, they don't deserve it as much as the first one. But I still got to think about the thumb, you see. And I'm also thinking about maybe we can do it together, all fingers together. I'm also thinking about that. And then I need to think a little more about it. And you literally, we've been thinking our entire lives over just such an issue of what gets the honor to lift the lid. And the answer is there is no lid to lift. And so we're wondering, well, how do I honor what I've tried to do? And the answer is honor the continuity problem. In other words, zero times zero. If we've been trying to multiply zero by all these quantities, what gets the honor of being the best multiplier of zero? You know, is it 20 or 21? Or 25? 21, 22, 23, 24, 25? I'm thinking, what gets the honor? What's the most honorable multiplier? You know, instead of saying, it's all, there is no honor, we say, no, I'm going to give zero the honor. We're going to keep the multiplying issue of honor there, in other words. It's just zero times zero. So we're going to keep the honor, the issue of honor there. We say the honor now rests on what gets the honor. The continuity problem gets the honor. The continuity problem gets the honor. I am feeling, I have the sense of, there is a sense here. It's not stable, but there is this sense that this is the answer. So it's a huge shift. when I talk about we need to make a shift, there's no question. We need to shift from believing there's a lid to seeing there is no lid. There is no lid on oneness at all. How could there be a lid on everywhereness? The realization that there's never been a lid is shocking to us because we say, well, what happens to the honor then? All my sense of honor was who gets the honor to lift the lid. And now we realize there is no lid. And that's when we'll freak out. So we need to place the honor somewhere. Place it on the continuity problem. That enables the shift into the vision of oneness to happen. This is my reason is telling me this. And I'm agreeing with it. I'm saying, you know, reason, you are right about this. I would say for sure you're right about that. I don't know for sure, but I would say I have faith that this certainly is resonating as right with me. I know it's right. All honor to the continuity problem, put it that way. Now, when I have done that in the past, the vision of oneness did appear to me. So that just reinforces my belief that this is the way. You cannot drop the issue of honor. Pragmatically, it's too difficult because of the continuity fear. If we did, we would see pure clarity without any thought that we could ever not see it. Right this instant, that's what would happen to us. Whereas if we put the honor onto the continuity problem, we can still see pure clarity. But it would seem to be being seen. There would be a sense of it's being seen. It's like, again, zero times zero is still zero, but there's a sense of some multiplication taking place, right? So it would be a sense of that pure clarity is being somehow perceived or seen. Ultimately, we're seeing a reflection of pure clarity, honoring the continuity problem. But this is fine. It's a pure reflection. And this resolves the continuity problem. By putting the honor onto the continuity problem, that is how we resolve the continuity problem. That's how the shift is made. That's how the shift is made. So see, we maintain clarity and reason here by the mood of repentance. So we've been able to look at this extreme absurdity, saying, oh my gosh, I spent my whole life trying to figure out what gets the honor of lifting a lid, and there is no lid. Yeah. We've been able to look at it clearly with honor, honoring ourselves, honoring our creativity. Because if we were just to cast it aside, we would feel we've been dishonoring ourselves, our creativity. Because after all, we put all our creativity into self-deception, didn't we? Or at least, you know, a massive amount of creativity into self-deception. And if we were just to toss it aside, it's nothing. You know, we would, you know, we'd feel like we're dishonoring our own creativity. And continuity fear, you know, it arises around this too. It's part of it. This honor is part of it. It's part of the continuity. So put the two, the honor and the continuity problem, put them together and say, I honor the continuity problem. And, phew, you know, that's it. So I'm getting this, you know, tremendous wow reaction to this. So even when the vision of oneness arises, you will say, well, I am all honor to the continuity problem. Yes, I see pure clarity, vision of oneness. And yes, and all honor to the continuity problem. So you stay balanced this way. Even though balance isn't really necessary, in honoring our creativity, we still maintain that balance is necessary. So it's like zero times zero. There isn't really any need to have zero times zero, right? But in honoring our creativity of trying to multiply zero by something, we still feel the sense of multiplying it. So in saying all honor to the continuity problem, we're keeping our balance, even though technically there isn't any true reason to try to keep balance, because there's no issue of balance, really. But again, our continuity fear, because we've been out on a choppy sea for so long, now we're in a calm harbor, it's perfectly, there's nothing, no oscillation at all, technically speaking. But, so, you get what I'm saying. If we say all honor to the vision of oneness, and that's all there is, theoretically we could do that. But there would be a rebound effect, most likely, from that. A continuity fear rebound effect. It would be incredibly rare for anybody to just jump right in and just remain there. You know, say, pure clarity with no possible even awareness that anything could be other than that, and to function here in this world just like that. That is, would be, you know, prohibitively rare, if ever, you know. So don't be stupid and even attempt that. Just go into the vision of oneness with the honor is on the continuity problem. I honor the continuity problem, as well as honoring vision of oneness. I honor both, because both are honoring my creativity. You see, the continuity problem is what is left over from the creativity of self-deception, and the vision of oneness is the creativity of reality. So we're honoring both, but they don't interfere with one another, see? The continuity problem is just the residue of self-deception. It's not self-deception itself. It allows for the vision of oneness to be there when you honor both. But the honoring of vision of oneness is intrinsic, automatic, so you don't even have to focus on that. But the focus needs to be on honoring the continuity problem to maintain the sense of keeping a smooth stride here. Say, oh, okay, I can see pure clarity. No need, an effortless pure clarity. But don't get lost in it, as it were. Say, I'm honoring the continuity problem. This is the safe way. This is the right way. This is the reasonable way. This is the humble way. This is the repentant way. All of this can be gotten to by through the mood of repentance and honoring the fact we have a continuity problem. This is how I've gotten here, for sure. No drugs at all. Mood of repentance, humility, honoring the continuity problem. I have an honor problem, I have a continuity problem. So I honor the continuity problem. I don't have an enlightenment problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a vision of oneness problem, I have a continuity problem. So all honor to the continuity problem, that is the residue of my great effort to self-deception, this incredible creative effort to deceive so that we can create creations that don't know its creator. You know, just what an incredible effort that's been of creativity, actually. So this is the residue of that. So honor the residue of this. It's honoring our creativity. The residue of that is the continuity fear. Continuity fear. Continuity problem. So we don't want to get rid of the continuity problem right away. Let it sweetly evaporate, you know. Let it sweetly evaporate. Let the honor of the continuity problem make friends with the honor of the vision of oneness. And let that honor become one honor of honoring our creativity entirely. That will happen. That will happen. But see, it's a conscious situation we're doing. Intelligent, reasonable, conscious, humble approach. It feels right to me. You know, it feels right. Now, is the vision of oneness trying to get rid of our honor? No, it's not. It's not. It's just there. It's not trying to get rid of anything. Because it understands. It understands. It too honors our creativity. It honors all creativity without judgment. That includes our creativity in trying to undo our creativity. Which is what we've tried to do. So it does boil down to this issue. It boils down to this issue. And we're able to look at this issue without too much trouble. It's like, well, just don't struggle with it. Just don't struggle with it. Again, give yourself the opportunity to honor your continuity fear by not struggling. Once you see it, you don't have to struggle. Which is why you may be quiet. Which is why quiet time and talking is very important. One moment here. Now, from my experience, the quiet times, it's not like I'm trying to meditate and go within or anything. I'm honoring the process here of continuity fear and the wow factor of just like, it's so incredible. The progress is so incredible. I don't honor the progress and don't try to put it into words. It's you know, stupendous progress here. And so I'm feeling this like strain. And in shock and stunned that the progress has been so dramatic, you know, so incredible really. So that's what I'm feeling. When I like eyes closed and quiet, I'm not blissing out or anything. I'm like just, whoa. gosh, you know, I'm getting used to the high altitude here. I suddenly went up in altitude, you know, like so far, and just like, oh, wow. It's like going up an elevator, a glass elevator on a skyscraper, and whoosh, you go up 50 floors and suddenly you're looking out, the view is just like, oh my gosh, look at the view. And you go up 50 more floors and you're like speechless. It's just, oh, the view is just, wow. You're not thinking, well, how many floors did I go up? You know, how long did that take me? No. None of that, just, holy cow, look at this view. Honoring, putting the honor on the continuity fear enables us to drop, you know, all the delay. It is the delay dropper, is to shift out of delay. You know, so, of course I recognize that, and it's just like, holy cow. So there are times when you will feel it's better to just be quiet. So eyes closed doesn't mean I've shifted into peace. In this instance, it means it's like, are you kidding me? I mean, whoa. This is a new perspective. Hello, new perspective. It's like that. So, give yourself the opportunity. When you reach a new perspective like this, give yourself the opportunity of just getting used to it. Don't struggle. The clarity is there. You know, the words will come back once you get used to it. The words will come back. But for a while, it's like you can't find the right words. You know, it's like, how did I get here again? No, don't try to think, how did I get here again? You're here. You know, the view is here. So just get used to it. For me, it's like, wow, success. I don't want to think about it too strongly. You then start getting anxious. If you start getting anxious, back off. That's a struggle. You're struggling. So, you know, all this time I'm quiet, I'm not feeling anxious. Not feeling anxious at all. No. But when I start trying to anticipate, you know, and struggle with it, then the anxiety will arise. So don't struggle with it for a result. Don't try to apply it to anything, to a result. That does, then it transmutes it into anxiety. Honor the continuity fear. Honor the continuity fear. Honoring the continuity fear is the cure for anxiety. The path that I'm sharing is the cure for anxiety. As somebody who has suffered from anxiety to the ultimate dregs of anxiety. I suffered anxiety as bad as anxiety can be suffered. So, of course, this path is one designed for those who suffer from anxiety, is to clarify it. We all suffer from something, most of us. This path is the way to avoid that suffering. We stay in the mood of repentance. We give ourselves these times to to absorb the shock of progress, the wow of it, without seeing how am I going to apply this? How am I going to teach? How am I going to share? Oh my gosh, I'm going to be successful. Who's going to come see me? All these thoughts, forget it. No thoughts about applying this to anything in any way. I'm simply honoring the continuity problem and thanking the Holy Spirit, honoring the Holy Spirit, honoring the continuity problem, and just saying, wow, that's it. Wow is as far as it goes. That this is a very important term to cure anxiety. It is just stay with just wow. Just wow, that's it. You're not saying anything more. You're not saying, okay, what's my business plan? Nothing to it, just as wow, wow. And people think they need drugs to be able to get to this wow. See, people treat anxiety with drugs. It's not necessary. It doesn't work. It ultimately makes it worse. When the drugs wear off, you don't have the mental discipline. You see, you're lying on a crutch. And when you don't have the mental discipline, then immediately, how do I apply this? How do I apply this? How do I apply this? Oh my gosh, I've wasted time. And the rush of anxiety comes back, which pushes you right back into more drugs. It's a vicious cycle, drugs. Very vicious cycle. Makes anxiety worse. Whereas if you have the mental discipline to hold yourself to this wow, to honor the continuity problem, anxiety doesn't arise. And I can just smoothly go on to functioning in the world. It's no problem. No problem at all. There's a little continuity issue of coming out of the profound wow and then talking to people. So you do need to ease into it. And there's a little choppiness. It can be at times. But not anxiety. It might be a little irritation. But then just say, honor that. Say, I don't have an irritation problem. I have a continuity problem. And it centers you again. So, again, it stands to reason that someone who tasted the absolute dregs of anxiety and suffered from it for so long would be very much attuned to what works to resolve this problem for sure. I mean, never a second goes by where I'm not focused on how do I completely cure anxiety. So it never comes back. And that's been my, you know, focus, just complete locked in focus for so long. Honoring the continuity problem is the way. And you can practice. I don't have an anxiety problem. I have a continuity problem. I don't have any problem. I have a continuity problem. You can name all these problems. That's super important. Super important. So again, drugs are temporary crutch that make things worse in the long run. In the big picture, it makes it worse. And then you're really up a creek, right? When you realize that drugs don't work, what happens? You go to a stronger drug when you're treating anxiety or depression or despair. And that's a crutch that seems to work for a while, and then you go to, and then it stops. You realize, wait a minute, when it wears off, I got a worse problem. And you say, I need a new drug. And it goes on and on. It goes on and on, it gets worse and worse. This is, anyone with half a brain can see this, can recognize from history is littered with drug problems and the unhappy outcomes of that. Spiritual path, spiritual discipline, commitment is the way to resolve this. So even on the very brink, you know, here of pure clarity, vision of oneness, I'm not anxious. I do have this wow feeling, a strain. I have a strain and a tiredness and a wow feeling. but not anxiety. There's some fear, but not anxiety. It's not anxiety. It's like you've gone to a higher altitude. I'm like, wow, how do I breathe up here? Let me get used to breathing up here. So if you're in that situation, you might feel a little nervous about, am I going to be able to breathe here? Yeah, but no, I'm breathing fine. So it's that kind of thing. It's just a sort of, wow, what a challenge. What an amazing situation I'm in. But again, it has positive overtones, so it's balanced. It's balanced. This balancedness is this wow feeling. I'm like, wow, I thought I would be completely freaked out, and I'm not. Wow, yeah. But honor the wow. Honor the freak out, the creativity of trying to convince ourselves we should be freaked out by the vision of oneness. You're starting to struggle? No. Drop that train of thought. Don't struggle. Don't struggle. Don't try to be too smart with this. Yeah. Just seem to be really dumb for a while. Just wow, that's all. You know, in drugs, people are just in that, wow, man, this is so heavy. Wow. You know, they seem kind of stupid. They're just in this, wow, I'm being freaked out, but I'm not being freaked out. You know, this is like, wow. But when it wears off, it's a different story. It's a different story. Whereas when I go about my day and I'm not focused on this taping, I'm still can be able to continue this clarification. There is no, you know, strong wearing off. There's a little wearing off, but there's no, you know, anxiety or struggle so much. No, it's not like that. Way better than drugs. The spiritual path is way better than drugs. Extremely better. Now, the only thing is you can't be lazy. That's the only issue here. Now, people ultimately take drugs to honor their creativity. You know, so, but if you shift your honor over to, from thinking to continuity problem, you don't need drugs. People want to still take drugs because they want to keep honoring their thinking, their creativity. They say, I don't want to stop honoring it, so I know the drugs will wear off, you see. It's that thing, it's that way. When you say, no, okay, I'll keep honoring my creativity by honoring the continuity problem, doesn't need to wear off. You don't need, your experience doesn't need to wear off. The experience of wow doesn't need to wear off. So the ones that get glimpses through drugs, etc., they're lazy, actually. And they still have this issue of honor. And they need it to wear off, you see. There's some rare, rare cases, perhaps, that are able to make some breakthroughs. Yeah. But again, always there are some rare exceptions. But it's folly to give consideration to that, because the rare cases don't need our consideration, really. Okay? They don't need our consideration. The rare cases will be the rare cases. That's it. Boom, 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 then, you know, they just don't have much of a continuity fear. But, so we don't need to consider the ultra, ultra, ultra rare cases. It's not a consideration of ours. So we honor the continuity problem. We honor the continuity problem here. We don't need the wow to end, then, do we? That's how we see vision of oneness, is we see. is what we really want. We don't want it to end. But then we say, well, what do we do with the honor issue, right? If we say, okay, I honor the continuity problem, then we can enter into it and say it doesn't need to end. Simple. And we understand that we will not enter into the fullness of it. It'll gradually be a gentle breeze. It's fine, gentle breeze. And gradually the breeze will increase until it lifts us up eventually. And we're floating, and then we realize that I don't even need a breeze to float at all. See, eventually, but we're going to honor the continuity problem and let it come as this gentle breeze. But it'll certainly be a wow factor to that, guaranteed. It'll be a continual wow factor, actually. But a blissful wow factor, you know. A happy wow factor. As we keep honoring our continuity problem. As we honor our continuity problem, so it's gradual, the breeze picks up gradually. But the breeze always has the same flavor, scent to it. Same scent. You see, so we get the scent of it. It's like, wow, what a great scent that is. Wow, how wonderful oneness is. Yeah. But it's smooth. So we stay in it all the time because we're honoring the continuity problem. Again, we're after the total cure here. I never want to go back to anxiety. So this is aiming for the total cure. This is honoring the continuity problem, gradual breeze, vision of oneness. Doesn't come on super strong. We don't fling ourselves into it. It comes to us gently. We honor the continuity problem, and we get used to it, like that. We're not flinging ourselves into anything. We're not flinging. We're honoring our way. All honor to the continuity problem. That's our will. And the vision of oneness has intrinsic honor to it, which we will feel as well, intrinsically. We don't know effortless honor. But the effort is to maintain effort. We put the honor onto the continuity problem. That's maintaining the effort. So that's part of the resolving the continuity problem, maintaining the effort, the honor, all honor to the continuity problem. So you're just hearing this, you're getting used to it. And that's very helpful. At some point, it's going to start feeling alive. Like there's a life to it. Say, yeah, wow. And just the wow feeling will, more and more will arise. Wow. Honor the continuity problem. I don't have a world problem. I have a continuity problem. All honor to the continuity problem. Don't put the honor anywhere else on any other problem. Okay, that's why I say that I don't have it. I only have one problem. That's the continuity problem. Therefore, all honor to the continuity problem. See, we've been trying to honor our creativity through honoring problems. So we don't want to take all problems away. We want to just have one problem, though. That's the continuity problem. Honor that one problem. Zero times zero. Very simple, right? You can get it. Your intuition can get this. And it's just a matter of doing it. Hearing it, accepting it, saying wow. And the wow of it. Don't struggle. Just, okay. Very great. See, like that. Okay, very great. That's it for this video.